And I remember then just lying at the bottom of the river, and I'm looking up, and I'm wedged inside the hippo's mouth, and looking up, I can see green and blue and the sunlight on the water's surface. And when I look around, I can see my blood mingling with the water. And I just remember thinking, I wonder if I'm going to bleed to death or if I'm going to drown. March the 9th of 1996. It was a day that I could go with the cliche that started like any other, but it didn't. It started with a sense of foreboding. A friend of mine who was supposed to be leading this canoe safari had come down with malaria. And I was, you know, when you have that feeling of trepidation, like something's just not the way it's supposed to be today. The opportunity when this mate of mine came down with malaria was fantastic. It was to lead a canoe safari down one of the most beautiful stretches of river, maybe in the world. Things were going pretty well. And we came across a pod of about a dozen hippos. They were just wallowing in the shallows, so I pulled up next to them. I pull the group together, we look at the hippos, we start talking about hippos. The size of them, what they get up to. Of course, there's always someone on a safari who's done their research and goes, is it true that hippos kill more people every year than every other animal? The answer is yes. So that's why we're going to stay away from them. Let's go around them. The third canoe, unfortunately, lost his angle and ended up getting bumped into some deep water. And the next thing I knew, there were this just like thud. And unfortunately, I'd been guiding for quite a while, so I knew that sound all too well. It was the sound made when a hippo hit the back of a canoe. So I turned, and I was right. I turned just in time to see the canoe, probably about 4 feet out of the water, on the top of a hippo that was jumping out. The guide at the back getting flung out, like catapulted out of the canoe into the water. That's not good. So I don't have time really to drop my clamps. So I said, okay. So we turn our canoe around backwards, and I start back paddling in towards the guide in the river. His name was Evans. And I'm paddling towards him. I'm like, hey, hang in there. I'm coming to get you. He looks at me and he's got these eyes that are saying, and you need to do it quickly. So I'm like reaching over. It's like a made for Hollywood moment. Like, and he's reaching out of the water, and as our fingers almost touch, just suddenly the water explodes and everything goes dark. I'm head first up to my waist down a hippo's throat. I'm so far down his throat, and I'm not a small guy. I'm guessing it's not that comfortable. And he like gags and starts spitting me out. So I manage to grab a hold of the tusks and push myself out. And I get out and I burst to the surface. I've been underwater a while. So I'm like, and I come face to face with the bloke who I'm trying to rescue. I'm like, we need to get out of here. Because I know things are just not as they should be. So I start swimming for safety, and Spidey sense says, So I turn and I look back, and the guy who I was trying to rescue, he wasn't going anywhere. It was where I'd left him. His eyes were like saucers as he tried to stay afloat. I think terror and panic had literally overwhelmed him. So I turned and swam back for him, and I was just moving in for your classic lifesaver's hold when I'm hit from below. So once again, I'm up to my waist down the hippo's throat. The hippo's just like thrashing me around. In fact, all I really managed to accomplish during that phase of the attack was to not drown. Anyway, the hippo spits me out again. And now I think, okay, I got to get out of here. And I'm swimming and I'm making pretty good progress when I look over mid-stroke and I just see this hippo charging in towards me with his mouth wide open. And then he scores this direct hit and he chomps down. And this time my head and neck and shoulders are outside one side of his mouth. And from like my waist down is outside the other. And then he just goes berserk. I remember at one point he threw me up into the air and I did this crazy sort of half twist. And when I fell back and he caught me in his mouth and bit so hard that I thought he was going to chomp me in half. One of the clients said it was like watching a vicious dog just trying to rip apart a rag doll. For me, everything was going in slow motion, which was really quite fortunate because I could think it through. I could think, okay, hold on to the tusks, because I had hippo tusks boring through me, and I figured out if I held on to them, then my flesh didn't tear so much as he was like shaking me about. And then when I went underwater, I could like hold my breath. And when I came to the surface, I like try and get a breath. And so this carried on for a bit. And then the hippo got tired and he dove for deep water. And I remember then just lying at the bottom of the river and I'm looking up and I'm wedged inside the hippo's mouth. And looking up, I can see green and blue and the sunlight on the water's surface. And when I look around, I can see my blood mingling with the water. And I just remember thinking, I wonder if I'm going to bleed to death or if I'm going to drown. But it was just a very matter-of-fact thing. And then I remember thinking, I wonder who can hold their breath the longest. And we're just lying there. Anyway, hippo must have, I don't know what he thought, kind of lurched towards the surface, spat me out again. And this time my mate Mac in his safety kayak, just incredible courage. He paddled in. We managed to get up onto a rock so the hippo couldn't climb up onto it after us. And yeah, that was the front end of a pretty bad day at the office. Mac did what he could to patch me up. We tore up some shirts and what have you. Emergency first aid. Then put me in a canoe. Ben agreed to paddle because we had to go and find Evans, the guy I was trying to rescue, because for all we knew, he was in as bad a shape as I was. We also knew it was dark and the chances of anyone coming to look for us were slim to zip. My blood is swirling around with all the water in the bottom of the canoe. The hippo's bumping against us and so full of pain. And I had this moment of, do I stay or do I go? Do I shut my eyes and just drift off and call it a day, or do I keep my eyes open and fight my way through it? And with that, I kind of had this incredible sense of peace beyond anything I could ever experience. And so I made my choice to stick around. And the second I made that choice, oh la la, my body was infused with more pain than I ever thought a body could handle. Pain was so intense that I wished I'd made the other choice and could die. But by then, I didn't seem to have that option. But yeah, we made it to the shore. Didn't find Evans. They found his body 2 days later. Wasn't a scratch on him. Apparently, he drowned. Yeah, it took me about 8 hours to get to a hospital with a surgeon who could work on me. Turns out I had 38 major bite wounds. My left arm had, from the elbow down, had been just crushed to a pulp. And had been, they call it degloved. All the skin had been torn off. Elbow up, it was crushed too. So I'd like done the button up on my sleeve to try and hold the arm on. I had a punctured lung, which Mac, my fellow safari guide, my mate, had sealed with some saran wrap from a plate of snacks. I had a tusk through my foot. My Achilles tendon was torn out. And then I was kind of like a kebab. I had tusk bites through, had bites through both shoulders. Both arms were barely still attached. Bite through the back of my neck and my head. Missed the top of my spinal column, the less space you can put between two fingers, through the front of my face, through my cheek. I was a mess. I was a hot mess. When the surgeon chopped off my arm and I was being kind of an ass in hospital because I was feeling sorry for myself, he said to me, you know what, Paul, you're the sum of your choices. You're exactly who, what, and where you choose to be in life. And I wasn't real impressed with that at the time. It was way easier for me to blame everyone and everything else for what had happened to me. But over time that sunk in, and I realized that I am, that stuff's always going to happen. Stuff's always going to happen. The one thing no one can ever, ever, ever take away is our choice over what happens next, how we respond to it, how we show up in life. And I think that's what the hippo taught me.